Welcome to the Jerry Paul Podcast. This is Eric Wadera.
This is Alex Smith.
And Alex, we have a special episode today, Between Two Urns.
Between Two Urns. We have to give credit for who came up with this idea, or do you think he wants credit?
No, we can give credit.
We give credit? So who came up with this name?
Miguel Paniagua, who we heard from him that he was going to do an ACP session on Between Two Urns, including a funeral director or mortician, to talk about it in a play on Between Two Ferns.
Yep, but we are not going to be like Zach Galifianakis in our interview with our esteemed guest today, Thomas Lynch, who is an undertaker and poet in Michigan. He is the author of 6 collections of poems and 6 books of essays, and he has a book of short stories and a novel forthcoming. I was honored to meet Thomas after he published his book, The Undertaking, Life Studies from the Dismal Trade in the late 90s. He was a guest of Guy Micco, who's been on this podcast a few times at UC Berkeley in the late 90s. Thomas, welcome to the Jerry Powell Podcast.
Thank you very much. I'm glad to be here.
We talk a lot about what happens before people die. Sometimes we've talked about what happens when people die. I'm excited to talk about what happens after people die. I don't think we've done an episode on this. So, but before we get into that, we always do a song request. Thomas, did you have a song request for Alex?
I would like to hear Time, 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 Tom Waits' standard classic.
And Thomas, why did you choose this song?
Because I was once asked to write the last op-ed of the century for the Times, the New York Times. And I gave it this title, talking about how we can get plenty more of everything but time. It was at the turn of the millennium, and they thought that was cute. So,
it was like a eulogy for the century.
Sort of, yes.
Okay, Alex.
Absolutely love this song. It's so hard to do Tom Waits. So on this version, I probably won't growl it out, but I might do it on the recorded version that everybody hears who is listening audio only.
The smart money's on Harlem, the moon is in the street, and the shadow boys are breaking all the laws. And you're east of East St. Louis, and the wind is making speeches, and the rain sounds like a round of applause. And Napoleon is weeping in the carnival saloon, his invisible fiancés in the mirror. And the band is going home. It's raining hammers, it's raining nails. And it's true, there's nothing left for him down here. And it's time, time, time. And it's time, time, time. And it's time, time, time that you love. And it's time, time, time.
What a beautiful song.
Bravo.
I love Tom Waits. He's such a good lyricist and such a unique voice. Mm-hmm. Great choice. Thank you so much, Thomas.
You bet. Thank you.
All right, Thomas. I got to ask, Alex called you an undertaker. Are you an undertaker, a funeral director, a mortician? I don't know the definitions of any of those words.
Well, I'm all of the above. A funeral director is what goes on our sign because we don't want to be confused with the, you know, with wedding planners. And usually people, they used to talk about the undertaker's parlor. I always like the word undertaking because it has this meaning of a promise or a pledge that you pledge to follow through on. I think the agreement between, for example, the role I have in Milford, Michigan, and I've had since 1974 as the only funeral director in the town, is that when trouble happens, when there's someone dead, you can call and we answer the phone. And this seems very basic, but try it with your insurance agent or your pastor, you know, or your banker at 3 o'clock in the morning, and try it with your funeral director. I think you'll mostly get answering machines, but the funeral director tends to be the one who picks up you know, in real time and answers, because when there's trouble, we sort of we respond to that emergency, this emergent reality that someone we love has just died.
Yeah. And oftentimes unexpected. My mom died in a couple months ago. Again, unexpected. And I got to say, like, I've been doing hospice and palliative care for nearly 2 decades. And I had no idea exactly what happens or what to do or the process of it. What's probably the most shocking thing for me is that my lack of knowledge about what happens after someone dies.
There's nothing that inoculates you or quite prepares you for the difference between being and ceasing to be, which is literally a breath. But the difference in status for the one who has died, and quite remarkably for all those who to whom that death matters, the change of status is very fast, and it begins to sink in over time. And that's why they used to talk about, and the bed of heaven to your mother, and, you know, sleep and rest to you at night, because these are the things that wake us in the middle of the night, wondering if we did all we could, or the coulda, shoulda, woulda really mount up when a death occurs, you know, yeah. When we're outside the range of any correction, you know. So my mother died 35 years ago, and I still sometimes sort of catch in the breath when I see a picture of her in rude good health, and I think, oh, there was something she did besides getting cancer and dying, yeah. Which requires such a focus, you know, cancer and terminal illness of any kind, or my daughter's suicide, which was sudden, and though not entirely unexpected, not entirely unpredictable, it was part of a disease process in my understanding of it, in my experience of it. They died two different ways, but I must say that grief has a way of coming round and round and round again. You know, we like to put it into nice stages and yeah. Talk about a year of mourning or the month's mind mass, or, you know, we have anniversaries that go on and on and on forever. You know, without is Don Hall's word for being widowed, and I think that's as good as it gets. We are without.
You know, another thing I found very interesting, I've written papers about grief and thought a lot about it, but I agree that there's no such thing as like stages, but you feel all of these things after someone that you love dies. Like, it's overwhelming. Yeah. And numbness is part of it. But there was something about the rituals that accompanied death. So writing a eulogy or seeing that individual, we had an open casket, which was both very hard, but also I would say somewhat cathartic to actually do these rituals and participate in these rituals. And I wonder your thoughts about that.
I'm always touched by the notion that particularly in our country, we speak about open casket funerals. You know, it's a luxury to have a casket in most places.
Yeah.
If they come at all at the end, you know. In other places, in most rural communities, the dead are laid out in their own beds, which is very often where they died. So someone comes in, as they do in West Clare, shifts the body to another bed or to a stretcher or to the floor, remakes the bed with fresh linens, puts the body back in the bed, props a prayer book under their chin to keep their mouth closed, pennies on the eyes to keep the lids closed, holds the hand and wraps it with a rosary to keep them tight. They might put bottles under each arm to keep the arms in place so the hands stay together. And this laying out of the dead is done across the world in every culture, with or without caskets. The casket has little to do with it, but ever since 1963, when Jessica Mitford wrote The American Way of Death, we somehow have confused the value of the wake and funeral and all that after-death activity with the stuff instead of the substance. So we think of the boxes first. And that's because Jessica Mitford wrote a wonderful book about the cost of boxes and the cost of flowers and all the sort of...
It's crazy expensive. It is.
It's very pricey.
Yeah.
Or not. It just depends.
Yeah.
It just depends.
There was a full range of caskets. I was shocked by some of the prices at the high end.
Well, wow. Yeah. In this way, it's like other merchandise. I mean, yeah. I have, in our funeral home, I have boxes from $79 to $7,900. None of them will get you into heaven or keep you out. They're just boxes. But everybody wants to do or say or show something with their choice of boxes. Yeah. Now, you can't fix a broken relationship by putting it in this box or that box. The box is a box is a box.
Yeah.
Cardboard costs less than mahogany. And this is true if you're, you know, whatever you're buying, from heads of lettuce to automobiles. Some stuff costs less than others in the same category. But that's neither here nor there. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, it's less about the boxes and more about the bodies. And ours is the first culture in which, you know, particularly in the past one or two generations, we're the first culture that I'm aware of that has tried to do funerals without the dead guy. And possibly you've noticed this. Everyone is welcome. You know, the talk is uplifting, the finger food is good, the music is chosen for its uplifting in nature, the homiletics are professional, the clothes are well-pressed and often rented, and everyone is welcome but the one who has died. They have been shuffled off, secreted off to the crematory where they are, and the operative word here is just cremated or just buried. Whereas in cultures that practice cremation properly, it's a public event full of ceremony and ritual and expectation. Here it's done as a form of disappearance. And so the just means that we want to minimize any bother that attends a death in the family. So I have heard for 60 years now, when I'm dead, Tom, just cremate me. Nobody's ever said, when I'm dead, Tom, please burn my body because the fire seems like proper illumination of life's gift. Or
yeah.
It's warm and people can warm to it in an otherwise cold experience of death. Or it purifies, as they believe in India, you know?
Do people ever actually attend the actual cremation?
What a great question. Because I noticed the same thing like 40 years ago. In 40 years ago, most of our deaths ended in a burial, maybe 10% or 15% or 20% as the decades went on from the 1960s were cremations, and no one went to the crematory. But I kept thinking to myself, if, you know, when my mother died, I wanted to go to the graveside. I wanted to see her body into the ground, and I wanted to have a shovel in hand to cover it.
Yeah.
We did all those things. And a lot of people, no one, unless the weather's terrible or some other calamity occurs, people go to the graveside because it's an important place. They go the distance with their dead unless they burn them. And here's why. We like the industrial efficiency and the cost efficiency of fire. We just don't want to, we think of fire, though, in Western thought particularly, as punitive or wasteful. When you're in trouble with God, you go to hell where you're not freeze-dried, you burn, according to, you know, the orthodoxies. Or if, you know, that we burn the trash, we bury the treasure, these kind of tropes inform the mindset that keeps people, if someone's going to be cremated, that's done in private. Somebody like me goes to the retort. So for 50 years, I've been saying to families, you know, when we go to the crematory, we do it by appointment, just like when we go to the cemetery to bury. Why don't you come with us? Why don't you help us lift the person into the retort, into the fire? It might have some use to you.
Yeah.
Maybe you'd like to push the button. Maybe you'd like to say a prayer or read a poem or sing a song. Or
maybe they take you up on that offer?
How many do you think do?
Well, I mean, it's going to go back to my own personal experience is that like I didn't want to be there seeing my mom lowered into the grave. I am very happy is not the right word. It was incredibly important that I was there to be part of that process. It was incredibly hard, but it helped with kind of closure, finality of that experience. But if you just ask me what I would want, so I think the same thing here is that probably most people say no, but it may be helpful for them.
I think it might be helpful. I can tell you this. I have never, ever had a family who I have encouraged to go to the crematory. I've never had one turn around after they've lifted the often boxed body into the retort with help from their nephew or cousin or granddaughter or whatever it might be. It's a job that two people can usually do.
Yeah.
And I've never had anybody turn and say, that was cruel that you made me do this.
Yeah.
Or I wish I didn't come here.
Yeah.
Invariably, they say, thank you. That was important for me.
Mm.
So how many people actually?
I don't know. I'm just going by the numbers. Less than 15% mm-hmm. of the now 2/3 of the deaths that end in cremation, at least in most of this country, 2/3 of the deaths end in cremation. I dare say were, if you're in San Francisco, it's more than mm-hmm. 2/3. But of that, less than 15% actually go to the place where the fire is to take part in that. And it's because we have negative ideas about fire. We have lovely ideas about cremation. Mm-hmm. There's a difference between the idea of the thing, as I think it was Wallace Stevens said, and the thing itself. The thing itself is a duty. I've always said, this is my sort of rule of thumb. A good funeral is one where by getting the dead where they need to go, the living get where they need to be. It is by the proper and honorable conduct of those duties that the survivors of a death have to the dead to get them buried or burned or blown out of a cannon or up in a tree or off to the sea, wherever, whatever the oblivion we choose for them, our job is to go the distance with them, to get them there. And if we do our part, the lifting, the digging, the burying, the witnessing, whatever our part seems to be, if we don't farm it out to somebody else, if we just do our part, that gets us where we need to be, which is at the edge of a life we're going to live without someone who is sort of primary to our life.
Mm-hmm.
So I say, if you burn your dead, go to the fire. If you bury your dead, find a hole in the ground. If you're going to bury them at sea, take up an oar and make your way. But go the distance with your dead. And anything short of that, we're just shorting ourselves. We're literally not getting our money's worth. We're going to charge you whether you go or not. You may as well go and get your money's worth.
Very powerful. Eric, I want to say thank you for sharing your story about mm-hmm. your mother on the podcast. That was vulnerable, and I didn't know that was going to happen. Thank you for talking about that so openly. And from Eric's story, clearly, and from your words just now, you talked about this pushback against cremation and the concern about fire. And I think there's this other piece that we should acknowledge here, which is that it's the disappearance of the body and the death itself, the viewing of the death that people may be trying to, intentionally to avoid, and that open casket funerals or seeing the body laid out on the bed, as you described earlier, lowering the body into the grave, those rituals carry with them important symbolic meaning to the living who go on afterward, as they come to terms with, and better come to terms with, perhaps, the fact that this person has died, the reality of it. And so I see that tension in our culture. You know, we've talked about in this podcast, death-denying culture, et cetera. And I wonder if in your sense, that also plays into this movement towards crematoriums.
I appreciate the question, and it's a wise one. I think the first thing I want to do is disabuse any of your listeners from the notion that there's anything other than useful, noble, efficient, and beautiful about cremation. Cremation is an ancient and honorable way of disposing of our dead, just like burial, just like taking them to a place where the scavenger birds will pick their bones clean and returning to get those bones and turn them into the icons that they are. So there's nothing at all wrong with cremation. But in this culture, we haven't learned to take full advantage of the honorable and beautiful and great functional way it is of disposing of our dead, because we've confused its value with its cost. We've said it costs less than burial, therefore it's better. And it may be better. I mean, I'm only speaking from our own family experience, and we have buried some of our dead. We burned some of our dead. It just depends on the family preference, on the individuals involved. But I have to say, if cremation is done properly and for the right motivations, it's beautiful and it's powerful in terms of its symbolic and metaphoric value to the living. But when I speak about the proper motivations, I just don't think saving a third on the cemetery expenses is a proper motivation. Now, I understand that money matters. You know, I raised four children, and I know that everything costs too much whenever it costs anything. So I get that part. But my job is not to tell you what to spend on a funeral. I think part of my undertaking is to tell you how to get value out of whatever it is you're going to do. Mm-hmm. And so whether you use a cardboard box or a box made of African mahogany or American cherry, it doesn't matter to me. A box is a box is a box. And by the way, I make a buck on the $79 cardboard too, you know. And I better, because if I don't, I close the door and no one answers the phone at 3 o'clock in the morning in Milford anymore. So I think most of the people in my town, I mean, if I take advantage of people in their grief, that gets around pretty quick. That's bad for business. Yeah. So I behave properly because it's good business to behave properly. Mm-hmm. And my son now has the business, and with any luck, he'll leave the business to someone he's related to or he cares about or trusts. Mm-hmm. So maintaining the reputation of the name on the sign and the enterprise itself is very important to funeral directors. Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of like the antidote to the upsell is the...
Confusing a call for help, which is basically a call for service, yeah, with a sales op, that's clumsy whether you're getting your windshield repaired or there's a death in the family. But I can tell you, it seems to me that anybody who tries to upsell, because I'm not opposed to anybody spending anything they want on a funeral.
Yeah.
Jessica Mitford's funeral, I have this from her family. I mean, her funeral was in the Lyric Theater in central London. I could bury 100 people in Milford, Michigan for what it cost to rent that theater. I promise you. But nobody said, oh, mom wouldn't want us spending that kind of money. Yeah. She was a great woman and a great writer, and she had the money. Why not spend it on this? What, you'd rather, another car or a trip to the Bahamas? That's what I hear oftentimes. Dad wouldn't want us spending this money. And then they go off on their world tour while dad's ashes remain in the closet of memories at the funeral home. Somebody just forgot to get them. It's
speaking
curious.
Of that importance of place, my dad died in the late 90s in Michigan, and he was cremated, and his ashes were put in two places. One is at the local church that I grew up in, the Unitarian Universalist Church in East Lansing, and the other half was in Hilo Bay. Now, the church has since moved, and they said they moved the soil from the area where people's ashes had been spread to the new church. However, I just don't have a connection with that new church. And Hilo Bay, wonderful place. I was born in Hilo, but I moved away to Michigan when I was 6 months old. I don't have a strong connection there either. I regret, and I've talked openly with my family about this, that there is no place that I feel I can go to to mourn my father in the same way that, say, my wife, whose dad also died, you know, 7 decades ago, has a grave site nearby that she can go to and visit several times a year, think of her father, pay respects to her father, that we can take our children to. So there's something about that place and that importance of place and choosing that place that to me is really important. I've told my wife, when I die, I don't want to be cremated. I want to be put in a grave with a headstone in a place that you and the family can access so that you have an opportunity to be with me in the, and invoke my memory at that place. I wonder if that rings true to your experience.
It is. It is exactly the case. And if you look at the increase, the steady increase since the 1960s till the present time of cremation in this culture, and cremation in this culture is only, 150 years old. I think the first cremation in the United States was in 1876 or thereabouts. So we haven't been at cremation very long, and it's normal to be a little clumsy at figuring out the rubrics and the traditions and the customs around it. But cremation is like our culture. We are all more portable, less grounded, more mobile, and more scattered than the cultures that came before us. The 20th century is a culture that, unlike the century before it, where everybody died in the place they were born, that was not true. Everybody moved every 10 years in the 20th century. And usually the move was not from this side of the county to that side of the county. It was from this side of the country to that side of the country. Big moves back and forth, and depending on contingencies that we never reckoned on a century before. And we had the means to move and the money to move, and we had the imagination to move. So cremation really works for many people. And the notion that it makes us divisible in the way you speak of your father's ashes being divided, so that places that were so dear to him or important to his history are marked by that. I also understand wanting to have a place that replicates the size and shape, for example, of my daughter's body in the grave where we put her with a stone at the end of it. When I go there, and I don't go that frequently because I live up north on a lake with the dog, but when I get back to Milford, I go to my daughter's grave, and I usually, you know, I shake a fist in the face of whomever's in charge here. You know, the woulda, coulda, shouldas. I wish I could have changed something about her narrative of life, but I can't. Those things are not in our control. But the grave is a comfort. Knowing where to go is a comfort. But I do think in a culture that moves and is mobile and is scattered, cremation can be expected to increase at least up to 80 or 90%. And with the exception of, you know, generational farmers, few people will be buried.
I got another question, because it may just be where I live in Marin County, Alex too. So San Francisco area, there's a lot of talk about green burials too. So Fernwood, right here in Mill Valley, you get no embalming fluid, no like stuff.
Sure.
Be put on a plot of land next to a tree. Is that a growing interest, or is that just...
Certainly the attention to our environmental dilemmas is across the culture, whether it has to do with our mortality, our medicine, our money, everything has a component that has to do with the environment and the fix we've gotten ourselves into, whether we like it or not. So it's not a surprise that even as corpses, we have to be good citizens of the environment, you know? So green burial, I think, works very well. The thing about green burial is it emphasizes participation by the next of kin and the immediate family and the community. So rather than having a backhoe spewing fumes from gasoline out of the top and digging trenches in the ground, what they say is come and dig, bring your shovels and help us bury the dead who are not embalmed. And they're not going in vaults. My daughter wanted a green burial. The cemetery in which she's buried requires like a, not a, a sealed vault, but a cement container to keep the ground from sinking.
Yeah.
They don't want it. They don't want the liability of people walking through the graveyard and tripping and falling and suing the township. So they say, use cement boxes when you bury. So my daughter is in a wicker basket. She was embalmed because she died, the bed of heaven to her, in Marin County, off that bridge where so many people find their release. You know, I think it was up until recently, up until the last 5 years, the most popular site for self-destruction in the country. Mm-hmm. Popular is an odd word to use there, isn't it?
No, but yeah.
No. But what I know is that in her, in the desolation where she was at the end, she left her husband, got in a car, drove across country, turned left, didn't make it over the bridge. Mm-hmm. Now, you know that there are bridges everywhere. And there are many times I cross a bridge and I think, I'm glad she didn't jump from this bridge because I have to cross it all the time. By the grace of whomever's in charge here, I might never see the Golden Gate again. But for months after her death, I would wake in the middle of the night for the reason most men wake in the middle of the night. And on the way back to bed, I could feel myself accelerating to the speed of gravity, that 32 feet per second bodies in motion will fall at, unencumbered. And I just wanted to feel how my daughter felt, looking first into that oblivion. And all I could think of, and I think all of us think this, whether it's about your dead mother, the bed of heaven to her, or your dead father, the bed of heaven to him, or my dead daughter, or my dead parents, or the 6,300 Americans who will die today, and life will go on with and without them. Whatever happens, we try to imagine them, and in doing so, we're imagining our own mortality. How we'll feel about that. And I can't imagine anyone working in an end-of-life situation in hospital, palliative care situations. We are nose to nose with the notion that we die, full stop. No adjectives, no adverbs. We die. That's our species.
And yet I still felt unprepared. and I'm guessing same thing with you and your daughter. There's nothing that prepares you. And it's very easy to try to protect yourself by trying not to think about it, not wanting that open casket funeral, or not wanting to see the body go down, not wanting to do the eulogy. All of those things in my own experience were so incredibly helpful because while I didn't want to confront things, it made me confront the nature of life and death and what it all means and my relationship to my mom. Like, I mean, I think that was for me the most important learning lesson about a funeral. It's about, in some ways, the ritual of confrontation about the facts that are before you.
We get stuck, and you can test this with your own experiences. I think the news of death puts us immediately in the middle of this imbroglio where we're drawn to doing nothing at all. And we're drawn, conversely, to doing everything we can and then some. Nothing's going to change the fact that we die. But we think if we just don't hear about it, say anything about it, talk about it, it'll all go away. Or if we buy this, that, or the other thing, or go this distance, or try this thing, or have this song, or if, you know, and we always have a list of people we should be mad at, right? Because somebody's got to be account for this. But most times we end up somewhere in the middle. We have our little say.
Yeah.
We write the obituary. We do our first version of biography in a paid death notice. And we have our weeping and our laughing. And we have a cheese sandwich when it's over and go home to the night. I mean, it's just the way it works. And a year later, we say, I made it. We didn't. We just did a day at a time, a day at a time, and things. We somehow retrieved that huge emotional capital that we invested in a mother, a father, a daughter. We get it back, and we might get back the nerve to reinvest it again.
Can I ask, as a, you know, we often talk about the role that we do in the hospital as physicians, nurses, being around death and dying. What's it like for an undertaker, a mortician? What kind of training do they get for their own kind of self-care and dealing with death and dying? Yeah, and I'm going to ask you after this is how you also got interested in this as a career path, because that's often a question asked of, like, for us in palliative care, hospice care, like, it's a conversation stopper. Somebody asks you what you do and at a party, and usually it's, oh, that sounds really hard, and then there's nowhere to go with that conversation. But
someone's got to do it.
What type of training do morticians, undertakers get?
They learn how to embalm. They're taught how to embalm because, you know, that's the technology that allows people the hours or days or, you know, it takes time out of the equation.
Yeah.
Before there was routine effective embalming, someone died on a Tuesday, it depended about the weather on Wednesday when they were going to be buried.
Which was surprising because I never thought about that, is that it, like, organizing like a Catholic mass on a particular day, that takes time, and it kind of forces the hand for embalming. And embalming wasn't it Civil War?
Civil War, that was the first time in this country's history when people died away from home in big numbers and had to be prepared to be taken home. It would take time to get them home. And now, of course, it's, you know, it's giving time for everybody to get back home from the scattering around the country that is true of most families, you know.
Kind of flipped it on its head there.
A little bit, but time is still critical. And this is the difference between the so-called celebration of life that happens when the weather's good and everybody's on vacation. It takes that sort of emergency. We got to do something now about this. So it. And that's how we've separated the disposition of the dead from the recollection of the dead. And I really do think the funeral with the body present, whether it's regardless of the boxes, but the funeral that surrounds a death in the family, including the corpse, is the one that works because it has a job. And the job is, within a proper amount of time, to get the dead where they need to go, into the fire, into the ground, into the tomb, into the water, into the tree, into the sea, whatever you plan. And you do it in such a way, it feels like an emergency, so get on with it.
Yeah.
But it still gives you time to order the cheesecake and the luncheonette church and that kind of stuff.
I also feel like it's the role of a good mortician or undertaker or funeral director is you're kind of, not an event planner, kind of a ritual planner, is that you're the guide for the family who often is dealing with this for the first time.
Show up.
And part of it's saying, no, like, you don't have to rush this decision. You can take a little bit of time. We will work with these people. Like, it is working them through the process of these rituals.
When I was a kid, when I was 15 and 16 years old, my father would plunk me at the door of the funeral home and said, open the door for anybody that's coming in and direct them where they need to go. It's usually in this room or that room, you know. And so I would open the door, and then when they were leaving, I would open the door and they'd go out. At the end of maybe a 12-hour shift of doing that, trying to look really good, I had a nice suit. I looked like a pudgy little kid who was told, he was doing what he was told. At the end of, you know, one night, the widow of the man who was laid out in the room came out. She had all her visitors had gone. Her family had gone on to open the house back up, and she came out with one of her children. And I held the door for her, and she grabbed me by the shoulders and looked up into my face and said, "I couldn't have done this without you." Mm-hmm. And that's very seductive. When there was no talent involved, I was just opening the door and closing, and carrying flowers from here to there. Showing up and doing the next right thing and being accredited with having done a great job at something. Somebody needed you to get through it. It's very seductive, and I've never gotten over that. It's why
was that your path into it. Did it ever deviate? Did you ever decide to do anything else?
Well, if my father had been a used car dealer, maybe I'd have been selling Chevys. I don't know. But he was a funeral director.
Yeah.
And he was the most respected man I know, including he had my respect.
Yeah.
And I thought, I wanted to do something that makes me like that. And I must say, after 50 years in town, the reason I live alone on a lake with a dog is because if I was still in the house next to the funeral home where I lived for 30-some years, 40-some years, 50-some years, I couldn't walk out the door without being on because the parking lot was full of neighbors. I buried every one of their families for years. So you can't walk out and people say, oh, he's retired, don't talk to him. So the only retirement I have, which gave me time to type and read and do the things that I want to finish doing before I shuffle off this mortal coil, is to get out of town, you know? And that's why I'm here. I read and I write and blather on to podcasts.
I want to get back to something Eric mentioned earlier. And a question we get a lot in geriatrics and palliative care, does it get to you? Like, how can you do this?
I think it gets to me in this sense. I think I go quicker to the worst case scenario. I have been with people on whom the sky has fallen. The worst that can happen has happened. Everything I do is an improvement. Even if I don't do anything, that's the effort to, you know, the effort to show up makes them feel cared for, you know? But I do go in my own thinking and in my own narratives of life and my own relationships with my children. I go to the worst case scenario. Mm-hmm. I really do. And I wish I didn't.
I wonder, Eric, if we could have a poem before the song, the closing song. Would that be okay?
I would love that. Thomas, we'd love to hear one of your poems. We will have links to Thomas's books too, so if people are interested. And Thomas, I also just want to thank you for being so very honest with us too and talking about your daughter and personal experiences.
It's like going to the shrink and not getting a bill, thanks to the both of you. Anyway, this is a poem called Walking Papers. And it's a kind of a correspondence to the first real poet, the first living poet I ever met, Michael Heffernan, who died on the 3rd of May. Yeah. I was just out in Arkansas for his funeral. And we were great friends. He was my writerly friend. He saw everything I wrote. He sent me everything he wrote. This is called Walking Papers to Michael Heffernan. I reckoned reading Frost would put you right, and making something from a line of his a better way to use what's left of time than trying to diagnose what's killing you. Something your doctor said about something he gathered from something in your latest labs. Letting slip some quibble about blood work or enzymes or liver function. Listen, something's going to get you in the end. The numbers are fairly convincing on this, hovering as they do around 100%. We die, and more's the pity. Same for the goose as for the gander. True for both saints and sinners, fit and fat. We get our dose of days, and after that we get whatever is or isn't next. Heaven, remembered, a kick in the ass, a place in a frame on some grandkid's piano, a grave, a tomb, the fire, our ashes scattered, the scavenging birds, the deep nirvana. Sure, one oblivion's good as another. By all accounts, there's nothing to it, pal. A cakewalk, kicked bucket, falling off the log. One moment you are, and the next you aren't. The way that semicolon slipped in there before the comma, in the following line, three lines before the coming period. You can think of it as punctuation, and maybe take some comfort from that, friend. A question mark, or exclamation point. No matter, we're all sentenced to an end. It goes on from there, but it goes on too long. I'll leave it there. And again, my thanks to both of you for your curiosities.
Thomas, man, I kind of just want to go over to your place right now and talk to you for another 5 hours. I really want to thank you for joining us today. This is both informative and I also felt like a therapeutic session for me. But before we end, Alex, do you want to give us a little bit more?
And they all pretend they're orphans, and their memory's like a train. You can see it getting smaller as it pulls away. And the things you can't remember tell the things you can't forget. That history puts a saint in every dream. Well, she said she'd stick around until the bandages came off. But these mama boys just don't know when to quit. And Matilda asks the sailors, are those dreams or are those prayers? So close your eyes, son, and this won't hurt a bit. And it's time, time, time. And it's time, time, time. And it's time, time, time that you love. And it's time.
And thank you to all our listeners for your continued support. And we'd also like to thank our donors who've donated more than $250, including
Nina Flanagan, Penelope Thompson, Lloyd Wolstadt, Mark Wren, Carol Heyman, Bob Rixey, Patrick Lally, Matt Schuster, James Tulski, Annie Hargadon, Jeffrey Galbraith, Daryl Owens, Meg Walhagen, Susan Nelson, Sharon Bragman, Harry Hahn, Jessica McFarlane, Victoria Braun, Diane Meyer, Mike Steinman and Dorothy Richmond, Wendy Peltier, Kelly Strait, Craig China, Ron Saber, Rebecca Goldstein, and Elizabeth Chung.
And again, those are the ones who've donated more than $250 in the last year. If you're interested in donating, click on the little donate button. Or if you just want to share our podcast on other podcasting platforms or Twitter or any other social media sites, that's good too.
And if I mispronounced your name, please shoot me an email. I will correct it the next time we record one of these. Thank you.